Welcome, everyone. We invite you to have a seat, and we're going to get started. Thank you very much.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and God's righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you.
Like the Spirit, nothing lifts me up like the Spirit, nothing lifts me up like the Spirit. I am one with the Spirit, and the Spirit's one with me. Nothing fills my heart like the Spirit, nothing fills my heart like the Spirit, nothing fills my heart like the Spirit. With the Spirit, and the Spirit's one with me. Nothing sets me free like the Spirit. Nothing sets me free like the Spirit. Nothing sets me free like the Spirit. I am one with the Spirit, and the Spirit's one with me. What makes me sing like the Spirit? Nothing makes me sing like the Spirit. Nothing makes me sing like the Spirit. I am one with the Spirit, and the Spirit's one with me. Nothing makes me dance like the Spirit. Nothing makes me dance like the Spirit. Nothing makes me dance like the Spirit. I am one with the Spirit, and the Spirit's one with me. One with the Spirit, and the Spirit's one with me.
Welcome to the people on Zoom, and welcome to you in the room. Welcome to National Soccer Day. Celebrating the most common sport in the world. And if you would like to know how the U.S. men's Olympic team did yesterday, talk to my grandson Emerson, who's sitting in the back there. He would love to talk to you about soccer. Whoever you are and wherever you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. There's a few announcements in the bulletin, some on racism from the Marin County Sheriff is what they're working on. You can look, access that at our website. Elizabeth River, who's a minister and one of our Congregationists, is leading a program, a four-week program on wise aging, living at peace. So if you want to sign up for that, you can look on the website or on the email. Anybody have a birthday this week? No? Mike? Peru's Independence Day, okay. And if you're into Beatrice Potter, her birthday was today, a long time ago. So, anybody else have any announcements? There was one mistake in the email. We just had Taze last week, so it's not next week. It's not the 4th. It's the 18th. Yeah, usually the third Sunday at 5 o'clock, we meet over in the seminar room, and we chant some lovely music together. Please take a moment and greet each other. Thank you.
Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. above us only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for, and no religion too. Imagine all the people giving.
Peace be with you. Nothing unites us like music. I don't know if you were able to witness the celebration of singing of that song over the last couple days, or maybe it reminded you, I think it was the Tokyo Olympics, where that was given as an offering. But thanks for that today. So this is a part of our service where we invite you to share prayers of thanksgiving or intercession that we can hold together as a community. And we respond with a prompt, "O beloved," and you say, "Hear our prayer." All right, so for whom and what do we pray today? And if you're online, I believe you can unmute yourself and we'll hear you in-house. Or if you don't want to talk, you can put it in chat. So, Jolynn, let's see how this works.
Okay, we'll try this. Yes, prayers for BJ and for her family, and also for Shannon and Annie.
Okay. Can you say that one more time? Everybody was so excited to hear you that we talked over your first prayer request. Sorry, Jolynn. We'll keep our containment.
Okay. BJ and Annie. I mean, BJ and her family, I'm sorry, and Shannon and Annie.
Okay. BJ and Annie and Shannon and her family. Oh, beloved.
Hear our prayers.
Thanks, Jolynn. Others? Jerry? Oh, go ahead, Lily.
Prayers of thanksgiving for the happy marriage of my grandson, Zachary, and his bride, Alondra. It was wonderful. Great party.
Great. Yeah, you are back east for a marriage of your grandson, yeah. So prayers for that, oh, beloved.
Yeah, lots of good Mexican dancing and tacos, too.
Oh, that sounds amazing. Sorry about the cross traffic there. Go ahead, Jerry.
Prayers
She's coming here. Good. We'll be on our best behavior. Prayers for Peggy and her safe travel, oh beloved. Yes, Pat. Yes, prayers of healing for a pulled muscle, oh beloved. Michael? Amen. Prayers for our country, oh beloved. Oh, all right. Oh, boy.
Also, prayers of enlightenment for anyone whose metrics are wrapped up in race and gender.
Yes. Boy, you want to preach today? So prayers for baby Charlotte and your friends who are her grandparents, Stan, and her parents, yeah. That's okay. But your friends are Stan and Jane. So prayers for baby Charlotte, Stan, Jane, and Charlotte's mom, oh beloved. And then yes, for those who cannot yet imagine a world beyond race and gender, oh beloved.
Hear our prayers.
And prayers for you as you travel this afternoon, oh beloved.
Hear our prayers.
Sue? So for Lorna and George's family and all those gathering for her memorial. Oh, beloved.
Yeah, okay.
Diane? Amen. So gratitude for Andy after his procedure. And yes, for the past week. Oh, beloved.
Your
Sophie. Yes. Yes, safety for all those who are spectators and all those who are competing. Yeah. Oh, beloved.
Hear our prayers.
Always, I'm sure people will always take prayers for safety, Sophie. Lily, go ahead.
Prayers for my daughter, Jade, who will be traveling from Maui to New York for family reunion in August 1st. And for myself as well, also going up to New York.
Yeah, prayers for Jane's traveling safety and for your time together as a family, oh beloved.
Thank you. Your prayers.
Other things to remember today? Yes. Amen. Yeah. Yes, prayers of thanksgiving for being settled here in one home, oh beloved. And especially, I mean, thanks to my wife. I was in board meeting and Diane said, let's take a 5-minute break. And I went out to the kitchen and I saw just enough kind of residual clutter that I had this tunnel vision and thought, I am not going to think about this right now. Not realizing that my presence and me taking a break was actually creating stress for my wife, because she was hopeful that I was in a room locked away while she was able to sort the kitchen. Anyways, when I came out of board meeting, the kitchen looked amazing. We had 4 gigantic boxes. I don't know what she did to wave her magic wand or how she fit them into drawers that still aren't overflowed, but I'm grateful for her and her touch, so I'm beloved.
That,
Yeah, for all those being affected by wildfires and those putting their lives in danger to fight those wildfires, oh beloved. Yeah. Go ahead, Anna. Oh. Yes. For, remind me of her name again? Emily and Robert, yes, and the grandkids who are traveling right now with the other grandparents. Oh, beloved.
Dish.
Yeah, prayers for unity, oh beloved. So for all those spoken and unspoken, I'll invite you to join me in praying the prayer that Jesus taught. You're welcome to follow along in the words on the screen, or to pray in whatever way you have learned, or to simply listen and receive this prayer. Blessed one, our Father and our Mother, holy is your name. May your love be enacted in the world. May your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive those we feel are indebted to us. Save us in times of trial and deliver us from evil. For all that we do in your love, and all that your love brings to birth, and all the fullness of love that will be, all these are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Our first readings today are from 2 Kings 4, 42 to 44. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing food from the first fruits to the man of God. 20 loaves of barley and fresh ears of grain in his sack. Elisha said, "Give it to the people, let them eat." But his servant said, "How can I set this before 100 people?" So he repeated, "Give it to the people and let them eat, for thus says the divine, they shall eat and have some left." And he set it before them, and they ate and had some left, according to the word of the Holy One. The other reading we have is from a kind of an interview on NPR by Adrienne Marie Brown. on radical imagination and moving towards life. My friend, Terry Marshall, was the first person to say this to me, that we're in an imagination battle, which just blew my mind. And I think about it often, that we live in this abundant world and we've been told it's scarce. And then we're given all these stories of scarcity. And because of that scarcity, we have to fight each other constantly. We live in a world where there's actually no superiority based on what we're born into, whether it be skin, sexuality, gender, any of that. But someone has imagined superiority, and someone has imagined it into a structure that we now all are divided. So much of the work for me of radical imagination is, what does it look like to imagine beyond the constructs? What does it look like to imagine a future where we all get to be there, not causing harm to each other and experiencing abundance?
With me, and you'll be in a world of pure imagination. Good job. You remember the Willy Wonka movie? I'm not talking about the Johnny Depp version, I'm a purist. I'm talking about Gene Wilder. Remember crazy hair Gene Wilder? That's how I knew him, at least. Yeah. Oh, no. And hopefully not less of my preaching, but thank you. I remember Willy Wonka as this silly, wacky movie, and as a kid, I was totally engulfed in imagination. Just that song led me on this magical kind of path. And what I remember about the movie is there were very terrifying parts, especially as a child. Everything, you know, everything doesn't start off great in the film. You remember that? They're all cramped into one bed, which, if you've ever had to share a room with a sibling, it kind of feels like that, or bunk beds, or what have you. That wasn't so bad, right? And then you see who your companions are after you've found this golden ticket, and that's not, I guess, so bad. But then you get into this world like Charlie does. You start to see all these magical, beautiful, weird things. And then there are these little orange and green people. And things start spinning and the music changes and things feel chaotic. The wild, wacky, amazing things are all part of your imagination, Willie says. And then so are the terrifying things too. You can stop anytime, he says. You have the power, you have the choice. But even choice is imaginary at some point, isn't it? Choice is imaginary at some point. Because choice looks different when you're 25 and able-bodied compared to when you're 75. Choice feels different when you're born with a genetic difference. Choice sounds different when your body is telling you something different than what's written on your birth records, which, by the way, someone else chose for you. So much of this life is determined by facilitated choice, not by imagination. At least not by our imagination. Facilitated choice, a favorite kindergarten teacher of mine said, facilitated choice is when you ask the kindergartners, would you rather do this or this? Because asking a room full of kindergartners, what would you like to do today? Can lead to chaos, to which I said, that also happens with adults. But facilitated choice, she said, is intended to educate us to weigh our choices, to give us values, to help us determine, to think through things, right? So you would ask some kindergartners, would you rather draw for 5 minutes or play recess for 5 minutes? and you give them an opportunity to choose. But so many systems facilitate our choices, and I would say override our imagination. But even these systems were imagined at some point. They were all imagined by someone. A just world for all is one where imagination isn't moderated by shame, projection, anxiety, a desire for control or profit, and it isn't moderated by disbelief. A world that is just for all, which, by the way, is the mission statement of the United Church of Christ, which we're a part of, is sometimes easier when it's imaginary. In the story, 2 Kings, you may not have heard of this story before. Maybe you're familiar with the prophet Elisha, but the Tanakh, the Hebrew scriptures, tell this story of imagination. This comes after the Hebrew people have been liberated. They had been removed forcibly from their homeland, enslaved by a foreign tyrant, and now they've been liberated. They've gone through their choices of wanting God to send a prophet. No, we really want a priest. Well, we'd actually really do better with a king. And so this book, 2 Kings, is an ode to that journey of theirs. The history, the context of this is that the religious order had already been established. So they knew what kind of offering to bring to make amends for what particular sin. Now, when I say sin, I don't think of it probably in the way that we've learned. I mean in a rift, a social rift. The structure, the strata that was provided gave you a category of how to repair things socially. And you can go back and look this up in the Torah if you'd like to, or you can Google it this afternoon. Each offering represented a specific area to repair relationship. And rather than hoarding all the offerings themselves, the priest's role, it was to feed them and to care for their household. But when there was excess, they were supposed to return it to the community. So this is actually a web of social care. That's what offerings were intended to be. The offerings are brought to Elisha, to the prophet of God, 20 barley loaves and some fresh grains of ears of grain. And Elisha says to his servant, feed the people who are gathered. Easy enough. We have enough. He says, feed the people who are gathered. And the story goes that his servant says, oh, there's 100 people and this isn't going to feed them. 20 loaves of bread isn't going to feed them. And Elisha says, just go ahead and feed them. And the servant says, I can't imagine this feeding 100 people. Please don't put me in that position. Just because you gather or worship or serve in sacred community doesn't mean that everyone understands the power of the sacred. Just because you gather or belong to a spiritual community doesn't mean everyone is engaging their imagination with what can be. It would take an additional amount of imagination for the servant to say, sure, I can go do that, why not? In fact, there's probably scenarios where he was faced with a choice. And what happens when you don't have enough resources and you're sent out to people? You could be swarmed. You could be injured. The very things you're bringing to share with them could be destroyed. And so maybe the servant is being wise and saying, I can't imagine that reality. Which begs the question, in order to engage our imagination, does everyone need to be on board with the decision? Does everyone need to agree with our mission? Do we at least need to be heading in the same direction? Would we do better to cultivate our imaginations rather than our sameness? Sometimes a just world for all must be imagined before we can live it. The story goes on, and when Elisha responds to the servant, he says, go feed them, because God's already told us there will be leftovers. And for the listener, if you have time this afternoon, I encourage you to read this whole chapter, because it's full of these fantastic stories, and you don't have to believe they're true. The point is that the people who were hearing the story would have known that when Elisha uses this phrase, God said there will be leftovers, that he's referring to the 40 years that the Hebrew people spent wandering in the wilderness, where manna falls from the sky, and God says, take what you need, but don't overtake because it will spoil. The people who are listening would get that audible cue and would know, oh, this is one of those moments. This is one of those moments where we haven't seen this thing before, but we're being asked to trust, or we're being asked to imagine the possibilities. We haven't seen it before. We haven't lived it before. We don't know what it's like, but we're being invited to step in with imagination. That's what this moment is. And Elisha uses that phrase, just give it away anyways. Don't you know? The Holy One has said, it can be done. There'll be enough. There'll be leftovers. You may not feel or believe that what you have is enough. Maybe you can't imagine that you have enough. Maybe you've noticed that socially we're in a place of uncertainty, or internally you feel the instability. Maybe your circumstances aren't what you had hoped for. But the words of Elisha are an invitation. Can you imagine beyond your circumstances? Can you imagine beyond your circumstances? Some of us are so used to looking at the worst case scenario. But what if we looked at the best case scenario? Not in a reckless way. Not in a way that says, well, you're not planning. You're not doing all the planning you should. Sometimes we're limited by our experiences or our choices or our circumstances. But the ancient Hebrew teachers often used this question to engage imagination. They asked this question, what's in your hands? What do you have in your hands? In other words, what's within your reach to do? If you feel stuck, if you can't engage your imagination, what can you do? What's within your reach to help? How can you serve? What can you offer? Or what can you rest with? Because not everyone needs to give all the time. Relying on a social network means some of us rest so we can discern while others fill in the gap, and then we take turns. Can you imagine that? What's in your hand? It goes back to the story of Moses. What's in your hand? For Moses, it was my stuttering, my past, my inability to lead these people because they're going to think I'm a traitor. The year ahead is going to be full of opportunity and energy zombies. The year ahead is going to be full of opportunity and energy zombies. It's going to be full of people who will say, it can't be done. I can't imagine it. It won't be done. And I would encourage you not to give them your energy. Imagine what could happen if you open your hand, if you open yourself to possibilities. To imagine an outcome you've never imagined before, because all of this reality was someone's imagination at some point. And it doesn't have to stay that way. Sometimes it's not our circumstances or our choices that limit us. Sometimes we're too busy looking at other people's hands. Remember in grade school, maybe you did this too. Check out other people's lunch boxes. What do they have? My mom loved to put raisins in our lunchbox. And to this day, I am not a fan of raisins unless it's in a bottle. And so I would always look, who would want my raisins? And I really tried to sell those raisins. Sometimes it's not our circumstances or our choices, but we're too busy comparing. And so we don't notice what's in our own hands, because comparison can freeze our imaginations before we ever get started. So Elisha is encouraging, do what you can do. Do what you have been called to do. And if you don't see anything in your hand, don't buy into the lie that there's nothing there. Don't believe you have nothing to offer. By the way, this man who brings this offering comes from the town named Baal Shalisha. Baal Shalisha, that's his home town. It's another kind of interesting clue in the Hebrew text, because Baal Shalisha is a combination of Hebrew words. It means the God of three, or the master of three if you translate it literally. In context, it means the God of the smallest, the God of the minutiae, the God of the most intimate. By the way, it is a feminine God. Don't have time to get into that today. But the point is, this man brings his offering out of his smallness. Can you imagine something else in the places that feel small in your life right now? In the places maybe where you feel too small? It's not our circumstances that limit us. Sometimes it's our capacity to imagine. And Elisha's servant says, this guy came from the smallest town. He has the smallest offering, and you want me to go? And Elisha says, yes. Can you imagine feeding 100 people with the smallest offering and then still having some left over? Whatever smallness you bring, can you imagine there being leftovers? Adrian Marie Brown, this conversation that Doug shared with, she quotes her friend Terry Marshall. I'll read it again for you. We're in an imagination battle. Boy, if you watch the news, it sure sounds like a whole lot of imagination right now, the news. She says, it blew my mind, and I think about it often, that we live in this abundant world, but we've been told it's scarce. And then we're given all these stories of scarcity, and I would add systems of scarcity. And because of that scarcity, we then fight each other constantly. But we live in a world where there's actually no superiority. There's no superiority. Science has told us there's no superiority based on your race, based on your gender, based on your skin color, based on your sexuality. But someone imagined that superiority. And someone has imagined it into a structure now, and now we're all divided. So she goes on to say, so much of the work for me of radical imagination is to ask, what does it look like to imagine beyond the constructs? To imagine a future where we all get to be there. And I wonder, what are the constructs you've been told are timeless? What are the constructs you've been told are timeless? Living situations? Relationship roles? Depending on politicians, church, they are shifting. Some of them are crumbling. Some of them are in need of evaluation. Fretting about politics is an exercise in imaginary anxiety every 4 years, especially in this country. And that imaginary anxiety has led us to pin all our hopes on candidates and electability. But the truth is, there is justice work every day to be done. Can you imagine the opportunities every day? Building relationships and softening hearts, finding common ground. By the way, many people in this country can't imagine a woman as president. Many people right now can't imagine a woman as president, let alone a person of color or a woman of color. And yet, many countries who fared well through the pandemic, socially, economically, and health-wise, were all led by women. Someone else has imagined it already. And yet, so many people here are saying, I can't imagine it. It's already been imagined. The same thing with waste. Did you know there are countries already who are practicing zero or close to zero waste? It is possible. Even if you haven't imagined it yet, it's already happening. Many people can't imagine an Olympics beyond gender, but some people can. Sometimes our imagination is limited because of our circumstances. Sometimes it's our capacity or our comparison. But a just world for all must be imagined before we can live it. If you go back to the beginning of this chapter, and I hope you do this afternoon, because like I said, there's some wild stories. The chapter begins with a story of a widow. She has two sons, and her husband has died. And the husband's collectors, they're coming after his debt. He wasn't very responsible. They're coming after his debt, and tell her, if you can't pay us, will take your sons and enslave them. She goes to the prophet Elisha and says, what am I going to do? I have no resources. Technically, they're now supposed to run the household. They don't have resources. What will we do? I'll lose my household. I'll lose my sons. And I'll be on the street. And Elisha says, what do you have in your hand? What do you have in your house? She says, literally all I have is some oil. A tiny jar of oil. What are you going to do with it, Elijah? I can't imagine you doing anything worthwhile with that tiny jar of oil. And the story goes that Elisha says, go to your neighbors and ask them for empty jars. And he says, don't just get a few. By the way, the same few, the smallness amount that's referred to in the town's name, right? Don't think small. Go to every neighbor you can and get empty jars. Go back into your house with your sons, close the door behind you, and then begin to pour the oil in those empty jars. And then I want you to go and sell that oil back to your neighbors in the jars they gave you. Pay off your debts, and you're going to have more than enough to live on. Can you imagine what the widow did? She must have laughed. She must have thought this guy is crazy. But she must have also been at a point where she said, I can't imagine it, but that shouldn't stop me from doing it. So she does go home. And she does collect the jars from her neighbors. And she does exactly what he says. Poured the jar. And the text says she ran out of jars. Not oil. She runs out of jars. Somebody here needs to get some more jars today. Can you imagine an end to your poverty because of community care? Can you imagine being the head of your own household is what Elisha is asking. Don't get a few jars. Get more than a few. She gathers, she does this. The answer to injustice isn't escapism, it's community. Cultivating a capacity to imagine a just world for all and then choosing it over and over again. There are crowds who are hungry in our county. More than 100. They have nice houses. They have nice cars. They have nice families. And they're still hungering for community. There is a hunger for peace, for belonging, for purpose, for rest, for play. And yet so many people know that these systems have already failed, these imaginary systems have failed. Can you imagine carrying relief to them beyond Sunday morning? The answer for injustices, for a heart of peace, the answer to beloved community, the answer for belonging, for a just world for all, for what people are hungering for, it's in your hands. It's in your hands.
imagination. Living there, you'll be free if you truly wish to be. You will find in your mind there's a world of endless fascination.
Thank you, Gabby. We hope you will stay for coffee after the service and say hello to our friends on Zoom. The offering plate there is back at the table with Raj. I want to offer a blessing for you, and then I will invite you to join us as we stand in a circle and sing together. But let me offer this blessing for you today. May you be free from the imaginary structures and systems that have told you that this is the way your life and the world should be. May you be free to imagine a truly just world for all. May you be released from the imaginary timeline that you've been told it has to happen within. May you be reminded that you live in a world and exist as a human who has abundance. May it be so. Let's stand together and sing.
A difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, yes, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference. We can make a a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Yeah, go make a difference. We can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference. Yes, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world.
Go in peace.
Right.